There's a book written called Psychological Studies of Famous Americans, and it examines from a psychological viewpoint Robert E. Lee and Ulysses S. Grant and Walt Whitman, people like this, and tries to explain in terms of psychology why these people acted the way they did, that they really did not act from valor or anything else, that there were deep psychological problems these people had, and that's why they reacted the way they did. One person they skipped that I thought would be a great subject for analysis, if they had analysis when he was around, was Ben Franklin. I think this man is ripe for analysis. So this is Ben's analyst, and he's in a typical analyst's office. He has a desk and a chair and a couch and an intercom. Yeah, who is it, Murray? Ben Franklin. Can I duck him, Murray? He's standing right there in the office. He's dripping all over the rugs. All right. Send him in, Mary. Mary, how's he doing on his account? 3 months behind, huh? Yeah, he's thrifty, all right, Mary. All right, send him in. Well, hi there, Ben. How are you today? Good. Ben, you wanna lie down on the couch there? Ben, you wanna put some papers down on the couch so don't get the couch all wet. Well, I'd say from the looks of our clothes, we've been flying the kite again in the rainstorm, right, Ben? Okay, Ben, we copied on our dreams, did we? Mm-hmm. You didn't have to. It's the same one. You're walking down the street, and you find a half dollar, and your face is on it. That's pretty sick, Ben, you know that? Washington has the same dream, only he sees his face on paper. Huh? You want to give George my number, Ben? Okay, Ben, let's see if we can't get to the bottom of this kite fixation thing. The lightning knocked you down again, did it, Ben? You're not surprised by that, though, are you? I mean, you expect it to knock you down, don't you? You know, Ben, you being a founding father and all, you know, it doesn't exactly inspire confidence in people to see a grown man flying a kite. You know? It's too bad it isn't something a little more private. You know, you could do in the privacy of your own room, like spinning a top. You know, something like that. You ever thought of spinning a top, Ben? Wouldn't knock you down. That's important to you, is it, Ben? Mm-hmm. Okay, let me see if I have the picture now, Ben. You're flying your kite, all right, Ben? And you're letting out the string. Everything's the same as usual. There's something different this time. You use strips of cloth for the tail. Red, white and blue strips of cloth. Where'd you get the red, white, and blue strips of cloth, Ben? From Betsy Ross. She's got plenty of it. She's up to wearing it, Ben? Now, Betsy gave you the cloth, did she, Ben? You took the cloth. A penny saved is a penny earned. Why didn't you ask Betsy for the cloth, Ben? She thinks you're a sissy because you wear bows on your shoes. And she chased you down the street yelling, "You're not thrifty, you're cheap." yes, you could have something there, Ben. Nothing, Ben. Why didn't you pay Betsy for the cloth, Ben? Keep what is dear to you if you would prosper. Ben, I think we can get a lot more done if you drop the little homilies after each each day. Ben, we don't seem to be getting anywhere with a kite thing. Let's switch to something else. How are the inventions coming along, Ben? You got lucky this morning. You don't have to wear your bifocals anymore. The lightning fused your glasses to your eyeballs. What are you going to call them, Ben? Contact lenses. Ben, I sure would like to be more optimistic about your condition, but I'm afraid I'm going to have to recommend a shock treatment, Ben. I don't like to do it because there are always undesirable side effects. Well, what we do, Ben, is we stick you inside the Liberty Bell and we ring it a couple times. You know? Well, the problem is you quiver for about 2 or 3 years, you see. Ben, I'm afraid our time is almost up. We'll see you next Thursday, then. Right. Goodbye, Ben. You get him, Mary? He ran out already, huh?